Good afternoon. My name is Philip Stevens. I'm a columnist on the Financial Times. I want to say, first of all, how pleased I was to be invited back to the ASEAN Forum. As John Hamray said this morning, it truly is a world-class event. For someone like me coming from Europe, it's a two-day immersion in the complexities of East Asia from all dimensions. I think this session this afternoon is at the very core of the summit, the forum subject, in that it's called Whose Rule, Which Order. As again, as John Hamray said this morning, if we are to have order, we need somehow to realign the horizontal problems that we all that governments face in the world with the vertical structures of national governments. We need some sort of rules-based system, the institutions to order, to set the rules and to implement the rules and to oversee them. I think everyone would agree that the existing order, which has served everyone, I think, well during the post-war period. For me, perhaps the biggest geopolitical event of the present century was China joining the WTO. China is a great power now because, I think, of that liberal international order. But I think everyone agrees that the existing order doesn't really quite fit the new geopolitical realities. Rising powers are beginning to chafe at their what they perceive to be their lack of representation. Some say that the design of the system, essentially a US-led design, no longer fits the interests of the new powers. So I think the big question for the world and whether we have, whether the new normal is order or disorder, is whether this system will continue to unravel or whether it can be adjusted, changed, added to fit the new challenges, whether from terrorism or climate change, and the new geopolitical realities where power has shifted from the north and the west to the south and the east. I have an extraordinarily distinguished panel, the best of the 2 days. I'm not going to read their read out their distinguished resumes. I'm going to start with each of them with a question, allow them to set out their views in 5, 6, 7 minutes, then we'll come back. And then as soon as possible, I think we'll open it up and try, as I said, to make it a discussion as much as a series of speeches. So I'm going to start with Dr. Chun Chi Min, who's Dean of Fudan University School of International Relations and Public Affairs. And my question to you is that I think everyone in China would say that China has indeed prospered under the existing liberal order. A lot of people in China would say that that order is no longer fit for purpose, no longer matches the realities of China as a great power. In some areas, in economics, we've seen with the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, China is already trying to complement that order by building its own institutions. In other areas, you hear Chinese ministers talk about the security dimension to the old order. I wonder, Dr. Chun, could you tell us how much China wants to change and give us some sight of the new international order, covering security as well as economic affairs, that China would regard as something of an ideal?
Thank you very much, Stephen. You know, and also thank you very much for our participants to come to this panel, not because we are the best, but I think the topic is the most important. I wrote a piece to the organizer before, but you know, Stephen asked these questions. So I think, you know, the liberal world order certainly has brought lots of the benefits for all countries in the world, more like economic growth, less interstate conflicts. But I think that from a Chinese perspective, there are at least three aspects this order has its problems. One is that you know, this is a world of power diffusion, right? But what we see from the China side is that the leading powers in the building of this post-Cold War liberal world order continues to try to maintain or even strengthen the Western dominance in world affairs. That has created a lot of problems with the rising new powers. And it seems to us is that particularly the United States is not very much willing to share the rulemaking power with other new emerging powers. And the second thing is that this liberal international order was based on liberal economies, market economy, and in the past, I think the United States and the developed world were the driving force, right, for the globalization, and they also provide lots of development aid for the developing countries, transfer some of the technologies to the other countries. So it is engine for growth. Right? But right now, what we see is that the Western world also become, you know, the source of a problem of, you know, bad economic management, producing that global economic and financial crisis. So not so much as before that you are a solution provider, but also become a source of a problem. And thirdly is that I think in the post-Cold War world that the military interventionism, adventurism, right, of the West has produced a lot of failed states around the world and made them the source of a lot of civil wars, refugees, and terrorism. So on that part, you know, when I was writing on that short note and I look at the introduction of this session, I was quite upset, to say diplomatically. It looks like all problems are caused by the non-Western players, right, like China, Russia, right? So I would like to hear to stress that you know, those powers that produced this so-called liberal Western international order should reflect that what's wrong with what kind of responsibility on your side, right? And then to see that what kind of reforms we need to do. So based on that, I think, yes, that is in the Chinese interest and maybe in a lot of other countries' interest, we need to think about seriously the issue of reform of this international order, which certainly means like more like representations from the other side in the global decision making. But I also at the same time to look at how we can best, you know, to provide solutions to many of the global problems. Whether the other side have, you know, good experience in offering these solutions and could be borrowed even by the West, right? On the security side, I think, you know, the Chinese government, my understanding is that they are not basically opposed, you know, the existing alliance system per se. They might be very uncomfortable with that, but mostly they oppose the strengthening, multilateralizing of those bilateral security alliance that the United States has built around the world and in this region. So I think for the Chinese, they still think that itself being a non-aligned country, it would prefer to see that how the countries can cooperate to jointly to solve those problems that are facing us. So there is hope, as Professor Tanaka mentioned in the morning, that in certain important global issues that actually countries can work together for the SDG and also for the Paris Climate Change Agreement. We should look into how the countries can actually make it happen to find some solutions to these important global issues. And then maybe we can draw some lessons and good experience and can apply to the other areas. So possibly I will stop here.
Yeah, thank you very much. Fine. Thank you. If I may, I'm going to come back to you okay. With one question, because you've been very clear, I think. Power, too much power still rests with the Western institutions. The West, in terms economically, has become a problem rather than a source of growth, and the military adventurism of the West has created huge problems. And as you say, you don't want to dismantle the existing alliance system, but you don't want it to be further entrenched or multilateralized. I suppose my question for you is, you said China's a non-aligned power. I'm afraid, as a cynical journalist, I don't believe great powers could be non-aligned powers. I mean, even India now admits that, you know, it can't really any longer be a non-aligned power. And I wonder, does China not have a sort of grander vision of the new order that we saw when President Xi visited Mr. Obama in California a while back? Doesn't China see the world somewhat through G2 lenses, that that the international order should be something sorted out at the top by China and the US?
I think that some of the Chinese scholars, possibly my officials in the government, might like that idea, although they could not say it openly to the public. But for me, I think this is old kind of concept, right? It's even United States and China might be two most powerful states around the world, but being a scholar working on the European integration, I still feel like the Europeans, right? If you act collectively, you are still more influential than China in many of the important issues. So this is a world, I think, going to multiple centers of powers. And even we see the empowerment of these individuals and the subnational actors. So it is more like a collaboration among all the stakeholders, and then it might find a viable solution to many of the problems. Being said that, I think that US and China, if they work together, that might facilitate a lot of things. The Paris Climate Change Agreement certainly is a good example.
Okay, thank you. We'll come back to that, I'm sure. But we're going to turn to Professor Kunimayaki, who's president of the Foreign Policy Institute in Tokyo. And Professor Mayaki, you've talked, I know, a lot about the rise of nationalisms around the place in Europe and Asia, and perhaps even, with Donald Trump, we see something of that in the United States, and the collision potentially between those nationalisms and attempts to build a different multilateral order. How serious is that threat, and what's your solution?
Right. Well, thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Chan Han Chabon for inviting me. You will regret that you're not listening to me. And I'd like to share with you, I was in Washington, D.C. a week ago, and I made a short presentation, but I'd like to reproduce what I said in Washington, because there are so many friends from Washington who haven't attended my presentation. There are three points. Number one, the dark side awakens. The dark side awakens, not the force. I see all over the world a widening gap between the rich and poor among the ordinary people, and they are angry at the establishment. And they have a very strong sense of unfairness. They think they are unfair and ill-treated, and they are very xenophobic, and a tendency towards isolationism. I think this is what's happening in Europe, in the United States, in China, and probably, my Korean colleagues may help me, probably in Korea as well, and of course in my country as well. This is a dark side awakening and angry at the establishment. So it's not a temporary thing. It's here to stay, because the Cold War is over, and now we are getting back to the real sense of capitalism, and the gap is widening, and the young people are suffering. That's number one. The dark side on the globe is awakening. Number two, empires strike back. Such populistic nationalism combined with the traditional imperialistic, I would say, DNA is creating a monster. Unfortunately, sorry to say this, but potentially in Russia, potentially in China, maybe in Iran, if I hope I'm not offending anybody, or maybe even in Turkey, potentially. The combination of such ugly nationalism with imperialism is to me, it's very, very worrisome. And the third point, I have no Star Wars analogy, but unfortunately, the proliferation of nuclear weapons will start sooner or later. I'm pretty much critical about the Iran nuclear deal. Some may disagree, but I see it almost as a beginning of the proliferation of nuclear weapons in the Gulf area. So these are the three things that I see in the world. Very scary. Dr. Hamlet just described the first half of the 20th century very ominously, but I probably have to do the same thing for the first half of the 21st century. How can we deal with these problems? There are a few tips, hopefully. It's not necessarily the order of importance, but I would say the most important thing is to prevent the gap between the rich and poor from widening. We have to deal with the economic equality and inequality, not only in my country but everywhere. And number two, probably our foreign policy, and especially those in the United States, must have been very much compartmentalized, that the Asia hands know nothing about the Middle East and Europe. European hands know nothing about Asia. And the Middle East hands in Washington don't care about Asia, to be honest with you. And this compartmentalization is obsolete, because look, the dark side is everywhere in the world. And it's time, high time for the U.S. allies in Europe and U.S. allies in the Middle East and the U.S. allies in Asia must get together and at least try to know each other, try to know what they are doing, if not coordinating policies. That function is completely vacuum in Washington. And otherwise, the allies of the United States cannot deal with this kind of a huge, massive dark side anger. And finally, it may not be relevant to Asia, but I think ISIS is also a part of this that phenomena. You see, and we have created, unfortunately, failed states in addition to Somalia and Yemen. We have created more, three more at least, Iraq, Syria, and Libya. And as long as those failed states exist, they are the nest of those extremists. So fighting ISIS is fine, but it's not gonna end. And they won't be go away. They won't be going away because they are there to stay, as long as they have failed states. So we need to do something, the allies to the United States, get together, hopefully, to address those issues as well. So these are how I see the world. I'm not representing my country, I'm representing myself.
Okay, thank you very much. So that's a fairly gloomy prognosis. Nationalism, imperialism, and proliferation as the essential threats to the existing order. I just wanted to pick you up a little and ask, clearly in the advanced Western economies, there is a serious problem with globalization in the sense that the gains of globalization have been distributed very much towards the rich, and lots of people in my country, lots of hardworking middle-class people haven't seen their incomes rise for long periods. So there's a general disenchantment, and you see that in the campaign in my country, for example, to pull out of the European Union. Let's throw up the barricades against the world. But there's also, I think, surely politicians who play on this, and you know, there's a bottom-up pressure, but there's also a top-down. I mean, some would say that Mr. Abe in Japan, just to be provocative, has played some very deliberately nationalistic tunes in order to sort of mobilize some disenchantment. And so how much of, when you talk about the rise of nationalism, how much do you see it as a sort of spontaneous reaction to the dislocations in the world caused by globalization? And how much do you see it as a sort of, you know, a movement by parts of the political elites to grab power, as it were?
Well, that's a very common sort of a misreading of what's going on in my country. Remember, Philip, we were in Brussels just about a month ago, and I was told by many European friends, oh, you're from Tokyo, you're great, your politics is so stable and so good. Look at Europe, look at the United States, look at Trump. They are in chaos, we are in chaos, but Japan is okay. And so I said, wait a minute. Didn't you criticize the Abe administration very harshly 2 years ago? Yes, we did, but you are okay now. Well, we are not always okay, but what I wanted to tell you is that, in a sense, administrations like Shinzo Abe's might help controlling, if not containing, such dark side, because he represents the conservative portion of Japanese politics.
Okay, thank you. We're going to turn to Dmitry Suzlov, whose current position is Deputy Director of the Center for Comprehensive European and International Studies. I think he also runs the Valdai group for the Russian government. Dr. Suzlov, I think it's clear that Russia rejects quite a lot of the post-war, post-Cold War international order. Certainly, the security arrangements in Europe, and it questions, you know, why do we still have NATO, given that there is no Cold War, and has come up with some of its own suggestions for a more comprehensive, pan-European security order. But on the other hand, and I was trying to provoke Dr. Chun a little by saying that China would like a G2. Listening to President Putin, I sometimes think, well, actually, that's what he'd like too. He wants to be seen as Russia was during the Soviet days, as the other superpower, as it were. Give us a sense of the order that Russia would like to see replacing the present liberal international system.
Thank you very much, Philip, and let me start by thanking the organizers, the ASEAN Forum, for your second invitation. I'm very pleased and honored to be here, and I totally agree. There is lots of criticism in Russia about the post-Cold War international order, which Russia regards as growing and deepening international disorder. And the turning point, I think, was 1993, 1994, from switching from order into disorder, when the United States took a decision to impose a Western hegemonic order based on the Western values, which were regarded as universal, and Western institutions and rules, and the enlargement of those institutions and rules towards the other countries. That was the turning point for Russia. Because indeed, you know, the roots of this disagreement, I think they go back to the fundamentally different understandings of the end of the Cold War, which for Russia ended in 1989, not in 1991. And so the parameters of the post-Cold War world order should have been established there. And Russia and China and other non-Western great powers should have been not just participants, but co-designers. And I would like to stress this word, co-designers of major aspects of the post-Cold War international order based on Westphalian principles and rules on the one hand, and collective decision-making on the other hand. Instead, we saw an attempt to extend the Western order, which originally was regional, not global, because the order that Truman administration built was regional one,
yeah.
Right? So there was an attempt to enlarge this regional, essentially, order to the universal framework, to engage the non-Western powers to participate, to join this order, to join the rules in elaboration of which they did not participate. And Russia, China, and partly other non-Western centers, Japan, India, Brazil, not Japan, sorry, they rejected this, either overwhelmingly or partly. Yes, of course, Russia also is a member of WTO, and China prospered a lot from WTO. So the situation is not black and white, it's very complex. And indeed, Russia and China and the non-Western players, they joined part of the Western liberal US-led international order, but also rejected many components of the other. And the foundation of the crisis in Russia-Western relations, I think, is not just the clash of some occasional national interests or occasional clash of national interests, but the order things. There is a fundamental difference in perceptions of what international order should be, right? What kind of order there should be in Europe, what kind of order there should be in post-Soviet Eurasia, what kind of rules should govern relations among great powers, are spheres of influence a norm or a breach of the norm? Does the United States have a right to regard some regimes as legitimate and the others are not from the very beginning and impose its own unilateral way of conflict resolution, or there should be a collective decision-making with full-fledged participation of Russia, China, and other non-Western powers from the very beginning on management of these issues and so on and so forth. So this problem of order, in my understanding, is manifest not in just Russia-US relations, but it exists in relations among the United States and all the other non-Western power centers. The difference of Russia is that Russia took it to the extreme and decided, you know, to challenge the United States in an outright and open way. Why? Because there were on both sides there were unfortunately no factors that could keep them from doing so, such as economic interdependence and so on and so forth. And both Russia and the United States, they came to conclusion by 2013, 2014 that they can allow themselves to be engaged in the new systemic confrontation, and they did. But the roots of this, the same problem, it exists in relations between the United States and all the other non-Western power centers. So in my understanding, we have been, and in the Russian perception, we've been witnessing a deepening international disorder throughout the last 20 years, and now we've reached the apex of this disorder. And in my point, in my opinion, there are two major indications of this apex of international disorder. One is that great power rivalry on the global level is back. We did not see it during the unipolar moment, but this unipolar moment is over, and power struggle, great power confrontation, not on the regional, not like between Saudi Arabia and Iran, but on the global level is back again. One component is the US-Russian systemic confrontation, which I think will stay for at least the end of the next American administration and at least the end of Putin's administration, which is the middle of next decade. The other component is the US-Chinese rivalry and confrontation, which is growing, especially in security and military sense, but also in economic sense, because the United States and China are disagreeing about order in Asia-Pacific. And the United States and China are building different orders in Asia-Pacific. The US wants a US-centric order based on rules written in Washington, as Barack Obama defined it, and would like China to join that order as one among many instead of being a co-designer of this order, and I don't think the Chinese would accept that. And China is building a different, an alternative economic order in Asia-Pacific based on the idea of the comprehensive economic partnership. So there is a growing polarization of Asia-Pacific both in security and economic sense. This is just to illustrate you that Russia-US relations is not just an exception, but well, they are exception in form, in methods, but they are not exception in rules and the nature of the problem. So we are seeing this outright open great power rivalry, great power competition at the global level once again. The second component of the apex of international disorder is a profound diversification multiplication of methods and tools of confrontation. Because, you know, some Russian observers are saying that we are in a state of total war. What do they mean by total war? That every aspect of life is becoming a tool of confrontation, a weapon, basically, a weapon in order to undermine the other side. We're seeing a comeback of arms race, and military is the weapon to undermine your opponent. Economic interdependence is once again the weapon a tool to undermine your opponent. Information sphere, political sphere, and I can go on and forth. So everything is becoming the weapon against each other. You know, the new norm of great power competition, in my understanding, is no rule. So the new rule is basically no rule. When violation of laws, violation of rules, usage of illegal methods becomes not an exception but a rule in great power relationships, in great power relationships among each other. What I mean is not just annexation of Crimea, which was also a result, not a cause, of growing disorder, right? But what I also mean is, for instance, unilateral sanctions becoming a norm of great power relationships, hybrid wars, information campaigns, support of color revolutions, and so on and so forth. So we are seeing this diversification of weapons and a situation of no rules. Now, at the same time, I think these same tendencies and these same phenomena create prerequisites for an emergence of the counters or preconditions for a new balance in the world. Not an order, but a balance. Why not an order, but a balance? Because I'm convinced that we will not see a universal order in the world in the observable future. Instead, we will see a coexistence of several regional orders, of several macro-regions, I would say, or mega-regions, mega-communities, which will share rules, norms, that will consist of like-minded countries, but these rules, norms, and values that will be shared by these regional orders will not be shared by the others. This is happening, to tell the truth, against the desires and will of either the United States or Russia and China, because both the United States and Russia and China would like to have a universal order. They have different understandings of what this universal order should be, but nevertheless, they would like to have a universal order. But instead, the strategy that the United States is using to restore or consolidate its leadership in conditions of multipolarity, precisely the turn of the U.S. from the strategy of strategic partnerships with all the major great powers, that Obama administration started with, to the strategy of consolidating its allies and partners in Europe and the Pacific, together with containment of those great powers, non-Western great powers, that reject American leadership, the strategy of trying to establish regional rules and to engage the disagreeing countries into the regional rules, since the global rules are becoming more and more problematic. I'm talking about Trans-Pacific Partnership, okay, and Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. So this is one component. But Russia and China, the countries that are disagreeing, they are not going to capitulate. And they respond and they adapt. They adapt by establishing the orders of their own. Okay. They adapt by turning towards each other. And the major illustration of what Russia and China are doing is they are already converging, or at least declare coordinated development of their two major Eurasian strategies, the Eurasian Economic Union and the Economic Belt. So this is unfortunately, the emergence of this two-ordered, if I may, not bipolar, but bi-ordered global system, which does not make life easier.
Okay. Now, look, that's about the most pessimistic thing I've heard.
Right. And I hope
today we could forget about the existing order. We are already well into disorder and great power rivalry. I have, just before we move on, I have one just sort of short question. I think we're going to come back to this question about whether China and Russia share the same view of order and disorder, because I think there's perhaps some differences there. But the question I have for you is, I perhaps unfairly, but I'm a journalist, so who's fair? I detected a yearning for the sort of 19th century concert of Europe type politics. If only Russia and China and the US could get together, perhaps not in Vienna, but somewhere agreeable and sort it out. That's the way to restore global order. Is that? Well, am I being unfair in suggesting that that's
well,
the sort of thing that you want?
Well, at least partly, not 100%, of course, because the world is utterly different from the 19th century. We have diffusion of power that you were talking about, with power proliferation to small, medium countries and non-state actors, and this is also the reality that cannot be compensated by the new concept of powers. It cannot be compensated by this coexistence of two macro orders.
But basically, you think that things should be sorted out by the big guys?
No. This is what Russia would want to see, right? And this idea of great power concert is, of course, the ideal picture for Russia. But in my personal conviction, okay, it will not help to deal with the problems of globalization.
Okay, fine. Thank you. A lot of food for thought there. So I'm going to turn to Evans Revere, who's non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institute. I'm just going to say at Brookings, actually, rather than read out this sort of long. Everyone knows he's a serious expert on things in this part of the world, but also more globally. I was reflecting the other day when Acheson wrote his memoir. He called it Present at the Creation. And this was the... And actually, if you read the memoir, it was a lot messier than it looks in retrospect, the creation of this that regional and then subsequently global order. But what struck me was that there was this happy coincidence where the US national interest coincided with a much broader international interest. You know, it was in the US national interest to rescue Europe, partly because of communism, partly so could sell Ford cars. So there was a sort of feedback loop which said the US stays engaged not because it's, such a wonderful, bountiful state, it's just that it's in the US interest. And similarly in East Asia, in creating stability. We now see the US pulling back. We see people, the last time I was in Washington, I was talking to some people in the Congress who said, look, you know, free trade and all that, the only people who gain are the Chinese. You know, why should we be helping with this liberal order, our potential adversaries? So, I mean, my challenge to you is, you know, how much is the US retreating from its own order? And how much is it adapting to the realities of the new geopolitics, to the diffusion of power between states and also to non-state actors? Try and give us a bit of a sort of summation, pulling in, if you like, some of the things you've heard.
Well, it sounds as if you were talking to members of the Trump campaign team, but I'll get back to that in a minute. Let me begin by saying my own deep words of thanks to Ahsan, to Dr. Ham Jae-bong, and to Chairman Chung for hosting this incredibly important and extremely timely gathering, and for inviting me back again. It's actually quite an accomplishment that I'm sitting here right now, because after watching that video this morning of Tracy Chapman singing Bob Dylan's Masters of War and all the chaos that was going on that screen, I seriously thought about going out into the garden and killing myself, but I'm here, so that's the good news. And I'm actually going to end up, those of you who know me, when I talk about North Korea, I'm usually a pessimist, but I'm actually going to end up in a fairly optimistic place in terms of the question that you posed and the questions that we are addressing in this conference here. A little bit more optimistic than John Hamry was this morning, even if I do think that the second half of the 20th century was not quite as bright and as positive as he suggested this morning. My sense is that the rumors of the demise of the rules-based international order are quite premature. I don't think it's fair to say that global order has been replaced by global chaos. at least not yet. Anarchy, in my view, is not the new normal. There are perhaps a few barbarians waiting out there outside the gates, but their threat, in my view, is hardly existential. And in terms of the dark side, I don't think night has yet descended. Without question, as we've been hearing all morning, as we've heard just a few moments ago, that liberal international order that we once were all such great fans of, that provided stability and prosperity and freedom, et cetera, it's going through a rough patch. There's no question about that. I'm not going to dispute that. We've got Russia, as we've just heard, which has a different perspective on what this order should look like, and it's doing things like pecking at borders and attempting to rewrite arrangements that we once thought were fixed. China is obviously keen to become, in my view, the regional hegemon and to replace the United States in a number of roles as the dynamic number one power regionally, if not beyond that. And of course, it's using its modernizing military and its considerable economic clout towards that end. And in a very confident manner, it's making various territorial claims that have put it somewhat at odds with its neighbors, but more importantly, at odds with international law. And Professor Chun, in his good comments earlier, suggested that China has its own vision of an international order or an approach to international order that it would like to follow. And my sense is, though, that the region and beyond is looking somewhat askance at that, mainly because China is promoting this idea within the context of a set of values and a political system and a social system that the rest of the region, if not the rest of the world, doesn't necessarily look upon favorably. Meanwhile, ISIS has been brought up, and certainly the radical craziness, the madness of ISIS and the remnants of Al-Qaeda have reminded all of us that barbarism and an appetite for the destruction of civilization did not end with the Visigoths or the Dark Ages. But let me suggest that as troubling as all of these and the many other developments that we've been talking about so far today, as troubling as those developments are, the world has seen a lot worse than what we're looking at right now. There was a time when US-Soviet nuclear conflict seemed not just possible, but imminent. I don't think that would be an accurate characterization of where we are today. There was a time when Soviet occupation of and suppression of freedom in Eastern Europe was the order of the day, and that was not that long ago. That's not the case today. There was a time when China, which today is exporting washing machines and electronic components, once exported revolution. Things have changed somewhat. There was a time when China was following a set of domestic policies that ended up with the deaths of many millions of people. That's not the case today. And let's also remember the Khmer Rouge, which set a standard for genocide that ISIS today can only aspire to. So none of this is to suggest, in my view, that the tough challenges that are facing the international community today are not difficult things that we need to grapple with. But let's remember that the international order, and it's not a US international order, it's a global liberal international order that has had many supporters and subscribers, that international order has shown itself over the decades to be quite resilient and a lot stronger, remarkably stronger than some people have suggested today. And the principles by which it operates, I would argue, are still very widely, not necessarily universally, but widely accepted. Meanwhile, as we look around the various problems that we've been talking about in this panel and the earlier panels, we're seeing an interesting example of how European solidarity and American firmness have pushed back somewhat against what Russia is seeking to do. in terms of rewriting the rules in Europe. China's assertiveness has, in a fascinating way, ended up generating a pretty considerable level of regional blowback. And in doing so, it has created calls from many, many countries in the region for the United States to do even more, to do things like maintain open sea lanes and enhance the ability of countries on China's periphery to defend themselves. And I think I would not be exaggerating to say that the demand signal for U.S. leadership, for a continuing U.S. emphasis on the rebalance in Asia, and for a very high-profile U.S. role in the Asia-Pacific region, that demand signal is stronger now than it has been in many, many years. And we see the Europeans in the aftermath of these horrific terrorist attacks beginning to mobilize themselves and organize themselves to push back against the horrors of ISIS. I think a lot more is going to have to be done if the liberal order is to be preserved. The U.S. is going to have to reject what I think is a very disturbing isolationist impulse that's coming from some quadrants of our political circles, but that's certainly not anything near a majority view in the United States. Even though some politicians may find it attractive to promote this view. I think America's Asian and European allies and our other partners are going to have to share more of the burden. But let me echo the sentiment that was expressed earlier today that by John Amory. Those alliances are as important and as vital as they have ever been, and perhaps even more so. But let me also suggest that we're going to have to do a better job of working with our Chinese and our Russian friends to bring them into the tent and work with them to help establish the rules of the game going forward, but not in a way that excludes other partners like the Republic of Korea and Japan and other players in the region. And so we'll have to do a much better job than we have been doing in recent years of convincing them to be the sort of responsible actors that we think that they can be and they should be. But most of all, and let me just wrap up here because I think I've gone on too long, I think it's going to be critically important for the United States to do what it has managed to do so well in the past, and that is to lead and to work hard at being the leader that only the United States, I think, can be. Because I think the values that we espouse, the values that we follow, the values that we promote and adhere to, I think are very, very broadly and widely accepted and appreciated in the global commons. And while those values may not be the same as the values of some of the other countries represented on this panel, I still think that they provide a basis for us going forward to manage things and manage things well. And so on that strikingly, for me, optimistic note, let me conclude there.
Much more optimistic, and thank you, Hans. But I want to pick you up on two things. One, you said the demand signal for U.S. leadership hasn't weakened, and I think a lot of people would agree with you. But the problem's been with the supply. You know, if you talk to Europeans, leading from behind means not leading. And you know, I'm just not sure one can be as sanguine as you are about the willingness of U.S. voters to continue to support this leadership role. But the other thing is, where I really wanted to sort of pick you up with was you towards the end, you kept on talking about others being responsible actors in this global system. But what we heard from Dr. Chun at the beginning is, and what we hear constantly, is that actually these rising powers don't want to be stakeholders in the US system. They want to be, as Dimitri says, co-designers of a new system. So how willing is the US going to be to adapt this system to give voice to others?
I was, to use the phrase that you just used a moment ago, one of the people present at the creation of this idea of the responsible stakeholder, the term that we initially applied to bringing China into the tent, as I said. And the understanding when that idea was first discussed in the wood paneled walls of the State Department once upon a time was that if we were to bring China in, if we were to bring other players in as into the tent and become members of this concert of powers that would help decide the rules, it was only natural that China would have a voice in helping to shape and, those rules and make those rules. I don't think that that's changed that much, but I do think that what we're seeing today is a disturbing trend inside China, in which some of the more liberal ideas and forward-looking ideas that were responsible for moving China in a very, very positive direction in the 90s and earlier in the century, there is a disturbing illiberal trend in China these days that is rather troubling and worrisome. And in talking to many of my Chinese colleagues, they tend to agree with me about that. But I think over the long haul, I think it'll be possible for China to get itself back on track. I think the overall trend and tendency in China is probably a positive one. But I think China itself is going through a rough patch right now in terms of the type of leadership that is in place, the crackdown on the internet, the crackdown on NGOs, the crackdown on freedoms, et cetera. There are some trying to turn the clock back, but I would suggest that of the 1.4 billion people in the PRC, the vast majority of those people have a view about moving forward, not moving backwards.
Okay, thank you. We've had four great presentations, a healthy measure, I think, of disagreement. The conversation's now yours, as it were. Maybe I'll take batches of two or three. And we've got this gentleman here first, and then we'll take a couple back there.
Thanks, Philip. My name is Dan Twining with the German Marshall Fund in Washington. I just want to thank all of you for the presentations. I wanted to get at this point that Professor Chen in his expert English alluded to, which is that great powers produce order. The international order that exists, or that may be fraying as we speak, is not something that's out there like gravity. It's something that is produced by countries and institutions and leaders, right? And I'll come back to the question on China, as how this relates to China, but I just want to ask Mr. Suslov one question. Also thanking you for your presentation in excellent English. The Russia you describe, a Russia that's at total war, a Russia that sees itself as under siege by a US-led system, is not one that I think many of us recognize. There's polling in Russia now, public opinion polling, showing that something like 2 in 3 Russians believe that their motherland is in grave peril. And of course, this is a product of President Putin's use of domestic media suppression and propaganda tools to convince the Russian people that there is this great external pressure on Russia from abroad, and I think particularly from the United States. And so I was just very struck by your presentation, which was most interesting and thoughtful, about how Russia sees the world and what kind of international order Russia would like out there, except that I think we can invert this and say that the kind of order Russia wants in the world is actually primarily a function of its domestic politics, and particularly its authoritarian system at the moment, rather than kind of a progressive vision of what it wants outside of its borders. When Russians talk about the threat of color revolution, a color revolution in Georgia that 95% of Georgians supported was never a threat to Russia. Of course, a color revolution in Moscow would be a threat to the Russian system. So it's just a comment about domestic versus international, which I'd love your opinion on. And then Professor Chen, your point about countries producing order and about how Western countries perhaps have failed to produce the right kind of order lately. I'm just very interested in this question of what kind of order you see China producing as it rises to become one of the world's most dominant actors. We can make an argument that, of course, China is interested in building, to some extent, a parallel order. We look at the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. We look at things like the New Development Bank, the BRICS Bank, and we see China replicating international institutions that already exist, of course, with a much greater Chinese role in them. So there's a question about China producing a parallel order, But then, of course, China also producing a degree of disorder in places like the South China Sea, the East China Sea, creating wedges in the U.S. alliance system. The alliances have produced a fair degree of order in Asia, certainly for the last few decades. So,
we're going to wrap it up.
The final point for our Chinese and Russian friends both is the fundamental problem in your views of how your countries can produce international order that most of your neighbors do not subscribe to those views? I mean, most of Russia's neighbors want to get further away from the Russian embrace, not closer. Most of China's neighbors are still members or partners of the U.S. alliance network. And how does this relate to your countries to build an inclusive order? Thank you.
Okay. There are a couple here, just in the middle row, this gentleman with the back here.
Thank you very much. Well, the issue of South China Sea.
Could you just, sorry, and say who you're with? Okay.
I am Raul S. Hernandez. I am the ambassador of the Philippines to Korea.
Okay.
The issue of South China Sea was discussed tangentially earlier, and also by Mr. Evans Rever. Now we are at the stage of waiting for the result of the decision of the arbitral tribunal. And this discourse is not only about the maritime entitlements of the South China Sea and also the rights of coastal states under the 1982 United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. But it also covers the principles and values that should underpin relations between nation states, particularly the rule of law and transparency and the rule of reason. This case that the Philippines has been pushing with the arbitral tribunal has gotten a lot of support from many countries. And this could have been a great opportunity if China participated in the arbitration in order to build a law and rules-based regional order where right rather than might prevails by free consent of all nations. Before I ask my question, I would like to say that it behooves nation to persevere in pursuing the future that we envision for our region's security order that is stable and predictable. It's not that power that prevails, but the rule of law that should be the anchor of international relations in this part of the world.
I'm sorry, so can I question, urge you to get the question,
yes, my question
we're running
now
out
is,
of time.
Will China abide by the decision of the tribunal and thus boost the rules-based order today? Thank you.
Okay, and there was a gentleman behind you. I'm going to take two more and then this gentleman here. Yeah, and then
thank you. My name is Christian Egenhofer from the Center for European Policy Studies in Brussels. I'm working on climate and energy, but I think there's still some points to be made. When I listened to this debate, I was a bit struck and wonder whether we are not really having a 19th century debate here by focusing only on state actors. I mean, listening to the keynote speech in the morning, it seems the world order and disorder is much more complex than just focusing it on the state actor. I don't want to repeat here the mantra about EU soft law. I think enough was said on this. But surely the economic governance will also play, should and will remain to play a role in all this global governance. And one of the interesting points for me was in the EU-Russia this debate we had in the EU, the energy interdependence was somewhat challenged, but not really fundamentally. So that part of the relationship remains still there. That was one point, and then such a second, and then my question. On climate change, again, we seem to be falling somewhat in a Western-centric focus, when you listen to the climate change people, you see actually that more the US was the problem on the climate change debate than the Chinese. But in our Western world, it's perceived the other way around, and I think it should be given credit to China to really advance also the US into this debate. And I think in the future we will see a lot of opposition still coming out of the US, whoever wins the election. Now the questions basically to our Japanese and US panelists. The Chinese and the Russian gave their vision on how they see the new world. Very interesting. I think I've sensed a small hesitation from the Japanese and the US speaker to share their vision. And I'm just wonder, what do you think about this idea about the co-designing, which in a way was brought up by the Chinese and the Russian? I just, you know, could you give an answer? Is that really an option, or are we just repeating the continue with the existing order, with including a little bit of Russia, China, and maybe some others?
Okay, and then this gentleman in the third row here.
Thanks very much. I'm Bill Patterson, the ambassador of Australia. There's lots I would take issue with, I think, with Professor Chun's and Director Sislov's presentations. But let me just ask a comment or seek a comment on two points made by Professor Chun. He said, as my notes suggest, the United States is not willing to share rulemaking power with new emerging powers. Is not the problem, however, that the US and the West and a growing number of countries in Asia and elsewhere do not share the authoritarian model of China and China's conception of values of democracy, freedom, transparency, and rule of law? I think that applies to some of what Professor Sislov had to say too. The second point I pick up from Dr. Chun's presentation, he said the West's bad economic management had produced the economic crisis. I'd take issue with that and suggest that China's debt-fueled growth and shortcomings in its management of that, in fact, suggest deficiencies in China's management, which have precipitated much of the current slowdown in global growth.
Okay, we're going to leave it there for now. If our speakers keep it very tight in responding to questions, we can then go have another session. And let's just sort of run it backwards. So, Evans, we'll start with you, and then we'll come along if that's all right.
Well, the one question I think it was directed at me was this notion of whether the United States is prepared to work with Russia and work with China as part of the creation of a more acceptable order. The simple answer is yes, and I think I made that point a little bit earlier. Let me just give you a quick example of the fact that I don't think that the differences between the United States and Russia are quite as stark and dramatic and as disturbing as Professor Sislov suggested a moment ago. I was recently at a Russia-US senior level track two dialogue on North Korea, a closed door event that took place over the course of about 2 days. And I was struck by the general similarity of views between Russian and American experts on that issue and on the need to work together, and the amount of overlap there was between Americans and Russians on this question of nuclear proliferation. So I think that's just one example of things that we can work on. And I think on China, I would just repeat the point I made earlier. I think there's general agreement among foreign policy elites, if you will, in the United States, and I think they will continue to be in power after the election in November, that China is a country, a power, and a partner to be worked with, not necessarily worked against, as we're trying to manage delicate international issues. We do have our differences, but I think those differences are manageable among reasonable people.
Dmitry, some provocative questions. But I'm going to pick out the most provocative question. Isn't Russia's problem that most of its neighbors want to be in the Western order?
Partly, again. Well, let me start by saying that the presentation by my colleague Evans Rivera and the question that I was asked actually proves my initial thesis that we are in the apex of international disorder. Because if the differences between the US on the one hand and the major economy in the world and the second nuclear superpower in the world are so fundamental, and we have differences not in just, again, occasional clashes of national interests, but in fundamentals and how do we read international order and on which principles do we think this international order should be established. If our differences are so fundamental among us, it means that we are facing an international disorder rather than order. Of course, you are right that there is US-led liberal international order, but this is regional, not universal one, right? And the attempts to engage China and Russia into this order, I think, at least in the observable future, are doomed for failure. You know, I recall speculations that Russia will become a normal European country, will accept American values, well, Western values, Western interests, will engage itself with the NATO-centric, EU-centric European international system, become part of wider integrated Europe, and so on and so forth. You know, from the Russian perspective, it was non-starter. Long ago, not with Ukraine crisis, I mean, but we didn't listen to those talks seriously since basically the start of 0 years. From the very beginning, Russian understanding of what does it mean to join what we called at that time civilized community, meaning larger West, was fundamentally different from the Western understanding of what that meant. Because from the very beginning, Russia demanded the role of a leader inside the prestigious camp, inside the prestigious group of countries. Russia didn't want to stay in the queue like Poland, you know, Czech Republic, or the Baltic states to join Western institutions. And Russia didn't even want to join the Western institutions. Russia wanted to establish the new ones with Russia as the second, maybe, player after the United States. I also recall talks about China's westernization and that China is doomed for eventual democratization. China is doomed for joining the US-led rules and institutions. Rules and norms in Asia-Pacific, well, we're seeing the opposite direction of China establishing a different order. And Russia is establishing a different, also regional order, right? So there will be this coexistence of regional orders instead of a universal one, unless the United States finally accepts co-designing of the new international order together with Russia and China and other non-Western players, or unless Russia and China undergo a fundamental collapse. And at least talking about Russia, I did not reject in the very beginning this option as well, although I think it is not likely in the, let's say, 5-10 years to come.
I'm going to move on to Kudi, because I got you can come back, because otherwise we'll get another
2 minutes.
Yeah.
Let me respond to a question by European colleague. You know, we have adopted free market oriented rule based democracy, not because we are defeated by the Americans, not out of inferiority complex at all. We believe in it. We were successful. Before the war, we were successful with those principles. And then after the war, we thought that this is exactly what we need to prosper. This is based on the experience, the past experience, in the past when we were not democratic, when we were not rule-based, when we were not free.
Dr. Chun, if I'm going to make it slightly more provocative, don't you have the same problem in a way as Russia, that most of your neighbors while content to have a very strong economic relationship with China, want to preserve their security relationship with the US. And those that didn't, like Vietnam, are trying to build a security relationship with the US. Doesn't that tell you something about China's not really going about this quite the right way?
Well, there's many questions here, right? Let's see how I can address them. I think that's not the case that most of the Chinese neighbors are, you know, welcoming the American leadership. And China has so many neighbors, right? You can name maybe possibly a few of them, a minority of them, they like the American's leadership. So that's one thing. But also, I think it is the state's choice, you know, that they try to maximize their interest when you have a multiple, like a big guys there offering all kinds of benefits. So I see this as kind of a nature thing. Evans, you know, that talk about this is the problem I think China particularly have with that. Bring China from outside into the tenet. Right, it's like we are in the cold, right? We can get warm in your tenet. I think for Chinese that China itself is a world, right? So we can live by ourselves, you know, in that case. For Australia ambassador, it says, what I'm talking about, the rulemaking, you know, responsibilities could be shared, is more about international policy making. So I don't think that the Chinese expect other countries to follow our model of domestic governance, right? But if they want, you know, that's their choice. Yes, the Chinese might produce some problems. We are talking about spillovers, right? So you might produce some negative spillovers, particularly like for the Australians. Now you possibly suffer from the low iron ore price. But how about those good days that you're enjoying excessive high price of oil, right? But at least we are not producing a systemic shock for the world, right? China is still increasing our imports of oils, but oil price is going down like that, right? South China Sea, I think the court actually made, not very wise decision to take over that case, because this is a hot potato. If they rule in favor of China, it might piss off many countries, particularly, you know, Philippines and its American allies. But if they are leaning too much on the Philippines side, then it would alienate China towards this court system, right? I would say that China would not, you know, abide by, and that would be another case then. So we were still looking forward to see that how the future governments in Philippines might try to find a solution with China and along with China ASEAN. Lastly, parallel world. Yeah, that's the topic. I think, you know, when we're looking at parallel world orders, might have two versions, right? Parallel but alternative. Parallel but supplement, right? So I think the AIIB and even the BRICS Bank based in Shanghai would serve, you know, mostly the function of a parallel but in supporting or generating new resources of a global governance. So because there's such a demand for investments, but the world institutions cannot provide that much, right? But I also have to say that it is also reaction to the reluctance of IMF to reform itself, even if, you know, all the leaders give such a nice promise in 2010, then it will reform, right? But you delayed 5 years. Without Chinese initiative for AIIB and other things, the US Congress possibly will continue to delay. So I see that somehow a competition is necessary, and that is the essence that we are playing hardball games, which we should not be, and it is against our will, as Dimitri talked about.
Okay, thank you. I've just seen a sign that says 5 minutes, and I've just taken an executive decision to to add 5 minutes to that. So we can run 5 minutes into the coffee break. That means we can get a few more people in and then a final sort of last word. So this gentleman here, if I could urge you to say who you are and keep it really short so we can get a number of people, and then this gentleman in the center row here.
Thank you. Short question. I'm Seungmin Choi. I'm going to the Gaming University. I'm a college student, majored in international relations. When I came here, I was expected to learn what's the new normal international order, but I felt like I was watching the UN Security Council meeting. Like, I was reading a textbook. So you guys kept talking the U.S. hegemony and the other challengers. I think that's just normal order. Then what's the new normal order? Is that similar to the existing order, like the led by a particular state, like a monopolarity or even bipolarity? Or then I'm still wondering, what's the new normal international order? Probably you guys are distinguished. Okay. I mean, definitely you guys are distinguished the panels, but
okay.
I
think we've got that. Brilliant. I thought I was being provocative, but that's a really strong, provocative, good question. This gentleman here, and then the gentleman at the back, in the middle over there.
Thank you. Stefan Moos, Salt Village. You mentioned a consensus on the values for the previous world order about transparency, democracy, freedom. When you consider what's been discussed for the next generation internet, for example, isn't the common ground shifting towards something more, to a different kind of rule of law, maybe less open? And when you see the shift also in certain leaderships in the region, be it RSS friendly India or a Nippon Kaigi friendly Japan, we don't know what will happen next in the region, but do you think these values will keep ruling in the future, or do you think democracies and non-democracies alike might find a common ground which is less open than it used to be?
Okay, and then in the middle, this gentleman.
Thank you. Leif Eric Easley. I'm a professor at Ewha Women's University and a research fellow with the Asan Institute. A question for Professor Chun. We've spoken about how states can reshape the international order. Could you speak a little bit about how international order can reshape states? In particular, there seems to be a lot of international disappointment that political liberalization in China have not kept pace with economic liberalization. Thank you.
Okay, and then this gentleman here and that gentleman there, and then we're gonna wrap it up.
I don't know who to address this question, but mostly I heard that nation states, sovereign states are making world order. But what's happening today, perhaps in a new normal, is that the non-state actors are making new orders. I take three examples. One example is Anti-Personnel Landmine Convention or Anti-Cluster Munition Convention. They are started by NGOs. The other one, the Climate Change Paris Agreement. It is not the United States who took initiative for it. Not particular country took initiative, but it's a general international worldwide views that promoted the movement towards this Paris Agreement. The third one, just two examples.
Okay.
So I think there's a new trend. Non-state actors, not the sovereign states, nation states, can create world orders now.
Okay, thank you. And then finally, this gentleman there, and then we are going to wrap it up.
My name is Henri Baki from the Woodrow Wilson Center in Washington. My question is for Dr. Suslov. Talking about the international order, the liberal international order was mostly economic. What I don't understand here, when you talk about an alternative or you want Russia to be a participant, what is it that Russia brings to the table in terms of economics? I mean, when you look forward, when you look at the problems that Russia is having at the moment, it's hardly the country that can, that has any company that is recognized. I would venture to say nobody has in this room has ever bought anything made in Russia, except if you have an SU-24 at home. But so, can you tell us about what economic benefit Russia brings to the table?
Okay, we've got 1 minute for each of our speakers, so I'll ask them to choose their question to answer. But someone's got to answer this gentleman's question about, you know, isn't this all a bit backward looking? Shouldn't we be talking about what the new order looks like rather than just sort of wondering what we can preserve of the old? But we'll go this way along. So Dr. Chung.
Thanks, Philip. I think it's a yes. I would say that you know, non-state actors are important actors in today's world, and my first book is looking at the local governments in foreign affairs. You know, the thing is that you know, once they could be good promoters, right, agenda setting, but once you want to have arrangement, you still need, you know, all countries and particularly the big ones to have, you know, to agree to it, right? So that's what the climate change negotiation is all about. The other outside-in effect, so what about the international order or arrangement might affect domestic things? But here I think possibly the most important thing is not focus on the particular type of political system, but rather on the governance capacity or the state capacity. Right? So whether they can deliver all the necessary things that people want. So I think that should be new anchor, you know, for our future analysis. So possibly that's my answer, you know, not just to try to think one universal, the best, you know, system or arrangement, then let everybody to follow. And that's the problem of the, you know, too much optimism in the Western liberal system. When you try to move to the Middle East and try to make their change and actually produce a mess there.
Thank you.
I'd like to echo that also, of course, non-state actors are important, but in a nutshell, it is not the states to decide the order or whatever. I think it is the people in a state who have the ultimate say in the future of that state. So let the people decide, not the states, only states make decisions on the new international order. Thank you.
On the economy question, very good one, I think that this liberal international order in the economic sense, although I think we should not distinguish because they are all very much related, but you asked about economy. So this liberal economic order existed when it suited its creators, namely the United States. As long as it started to suit the interests and the major beneficiary of this order started to become different actors, China in particular, we've seen the beginning of the demise of the liberal essence of that order. And instead, the same institutions, the same instruments of that liberal international order, the interdependence and global interdependence that have been established within this international order started to be used for punitive purposes, unilateral sanctions. And unilateral sanctions are not just against Russia, they are against China, they are against Iran. Russia is also imposing sanctions against the others and so on and so forth. Russia also joined basically partially this liberal international order in the economic sense, because Russia eventually joined WTO. But now we're seeing the weakening of the WTO, and the United States is deliberately turning, switching the focus from WTO to regional orders in which it is able to dominate, in which it is able to impose rules without participation of the other players, without the participation of China in the Pacific or Russia in the Atlantic. So this is why, in my understanding, we are seeing this fractioning and fragmentation of liberal international order in the economic sense, as just as we are seeing that in the security sense. Can I also use another minute to answer the question about the determinants of Russian behavior, which I didn't answer in the first round? You know, when I was talking about this total war, I didn't mean this idea of artificial hostile environment that Russia is creating. Of course, there is lots of propaganda. Of course, there is the manipulation of the mass opinion. But nevertheless, those elements of the total war are the real existing things. Again, exploit of interdependence, unilateral sanctions, and Russia is also an actor in this game of unilateral sanctions, hybrid wars, and so on and so forth. These are not artificial things, but these are the real things. These are the reality of not just Western policy towards Russia, but they are the norm of behavior of all towards all, at least the major powers, right? But also not just the most major powers. Turkey, Iran, Saudi Arabia, I mean, they are also engaged in this kind of game. So I do not agree that this is just the invention of Putin's propaganda. And I also disagree that the foreign policy that Russia is pursuing is a 100% result of the Russian domestic politics.
Okay, we're going to end it there because this gentleman at the back is getting very cross with me. So so I'm going to, he's putting up a sign saying, please end.
Okay.
So I'm going to, Evans, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to be rude, Dimitri, but.
Point number one, I hope I misheard him, but Professor Chan a little bit earlier, in responding to the question about the impending court decision on the South China Sea, said something that I found was remarkable and disturbing, in which he suggested that if the decision does not go China's way, that somehow China will make some sort of a break or change its posture with respect to the validity of that institution. I would just throw out there for his consideration and the consideration of the audience that the last country that did something like that and rejected a major international institution because it didn't like the decisions coming out of it was Imperial Japan in the 1930s, and that didn't work out very well for Japan. The other point I just wanted to make in response to what the new order will or may look like in the future, this is a process of evolution, and it's hard to tell at this point. However, if the new normal that we've been talking about here all day is going to be as horrific as has been described in the video and in some of the comments that I've heard here, that it's going to involve chaos and disorder and anarchy, once again, being an optimist, at least for today, I believe that the international community is going to find a way to respond and react to that in a way that ultimately preserves the sort of international order that best maintains peace and stability.
Thank you very much. You've all lost 8 minutes of your coffee time, but I said at the beginning that this would be the best panel of the plenum, and of course they were, so can we applaud them? Thank you.